These are Biang Biang noodles. They originate from Shaanxi in central China, and while they're delicious, they're perhaps more famous for their name, Biang Biang. This character, written in 58 strokes twice over for the whole name, is one of the most unique characters in the whole Chinese lexicon. Thankfully, computers have made writing characters used in both Chinese and Japanese much faster, but there are still some limitations. If you look at this menu here, you'll see that Biang Biang is written in a completely different font. That's because this character wasn't actually typed. It's just an image squeezed into the space here because, until just recently, there was no way to type this character. But why? Why are some characters unable to be typed, and what makes this character different from the rest of the words in the dictionary? The legend goes that a poor and hungry scholar, while making his way through Shaanxi, stopped at a noodle shop and was served a large, thick noodle that, when being chewed, made the sound biang biang. When it came time to pay his bill, the scholar, finding he had no money on him, offered the use of his expertise instead. He wrote down the name of the then unnamed food that he had just eaten, biang biang noodles. Now, while no one is quite sure if this story is entirely true, in fact there are several different origin stories, this is the character that has stuck with these noodles as they spread all around China and throughout the world, being carefully written on sign shops and menus, one stroke at a time. Several hundred years later, in the second half of the 20th century, computers were beginning to be used for more than just crunching the numbers. Microcomputers, what today we'd call personal computers, are proving to be great tools, especially when it comes to things like text processing. The words on this screen are kept in the computer's memory in the form of a standardized encoding, with one byte of memory representing one letter. This allows for the text data to be portable and intelligible between different machines and fonts without worrying about what the text actually looks like. While the American Standard Code for Information Interchange, ASCII, quickly became the industry standard for encoding after its publication in 1963, its 7-bit character set wasn't ideal for languages that used more than the 26 letters and various other punctuation provided. Other parts of the world either expanded ASCII to an 8-bit 256 character set, as was seen in India with ISCII or Vietnam with VISCII, or they had to invent their own encoding systems. Surprisingly, Chinese characters work differently from Latin letters. Each word in the Chinese language is represented by a uniquely written logogram, the set of which is referred to as Hanzi, or Han characters. Thousands of characters are required for daily communication, but the total number of extant Hanzi reaches to over 100,000, so fitting into an 8-bit encoding was never an option. The Japanese language has, for over 1,000 years, also heavily relied on the use of characters, which in the Japanese pronunciation are called kanji. When it came to the problem of creating a text processing system that could handle characters, it was Japan who first faced this problem head-on. But the first Japanese encoding scheme, the Japanese Industrial Standard X0201 from 1969, did not include any kanji. It was a 7-bit encoding that was based on ASCII, but also included katakana, one of the Japanese phonetic scripts. The first time kanji would be supported in an encoding standard wouldn't be until 1978, when the new JIS X0208 standard pushed the encoding size from 1 byte to 2 bytes. This standard covered 524 non-kanji symbols and 6,349 kanji split between two levels arranged in a 94x94 plane, and it was expected that the user's computer would have a ROM card that was filled with the graphical data of each kanji that programs would pull from. A few years later in 1980, China developed their own character encoding scheme, GB2312, a 2-byte standard which covered 682 non-Hanzi and 6,763 Hanzi split into two levels arranged in a 94x94 plane, and it was expected that a ROM card would be present in the system full of the character's graphical data. But this isn't a direct copy of the Japanese encoding standard by any means. This is the Japanese code table, and this is the Chinese code table. Besides a number of different characters, both tables are ordered according to their local pronunciation, making these two codes incompatible and independent from each other. Between those two nations lies the Korean Peninsula. While the Korean language hasn't been written using Chinese characters for the better part of a millennium now, their alphabet doesn't form strings of letters like it does in English. Instead, Korean letters form unique syllable blocks, and these are also called characters. So, while Korean is phonetic, they still have the same problem as Chinese characters, and the solution, first developed in the Republic of Korea, was also similar. KSC-6501 was developed as early as 1974, though thoroughly re-standardized in 1987. This encoding was a 2-byte standard which covered 1,119 non-character, 2,350 Hangul syllables, and, for good measure, 4,888 Chinese characters, arranged in a 94x94 plane. The Democratic People's Republic of Korea also had their own 94x94 plane-based encoding standard, though developed much later in 1993, covering 2,679 Hangul syllables, 4,653 Chinese characters, and 10 graphics, three of which were related to the Workers' Party of Korea. While these regional encodings did cover more than a few thousand characters each, enough for basic communication, without further linguistic coverage, scientific research, proper menu processing, and bringing the thousands of years of literature to computers was simply impossible. If a character didn't have a code point in an encoding, it was simply untypable. And sadly, it seems that Biang was not a top priority for these engineers, as there was no trace of it to be found anywhere. While improvements to each of these standards would be made throughout the years, it was in the late 1980s that the biggest shakeup in character encoding would begin. However, not in the Orient, but halfway around the world in the United States. It started when engineers from Xerox and Apple began trying to create a 2-byte encoding scheme arranged in a 94x94 plane. Just kidding. While it was 16-bit, the real goal of these engineers was to create the universal encoding standard. Their project was known as Unicode. The Unicode standard was created to be the final encoding to rule them all, allowing all computers to be able to communicate with each other without worrying about the dozens of different cross-language encodings. To accomplish this, Unicode does not encode language, font, size, position, or glyphs. Unicode encodes graphemes. While a glyph is a graphic symbol, a grapheme is the smallest constructive unit of a language. All of these glyphs correspond to the same code point as they represent the same grapheme in Unicode, lowercase a. The way that the grapheme is then visualized is left for the user's system, typically through a font, to decide. This allows for Unicode to achieve one of its main goals, to avoid the duplication of symbols in the standard. In the character-based languages of China, Japan, and Korea, the CJK nations, the characters themselves are the literary building blocks, the graphemes. To avoid the duplication of characters in Unicode, all these regional encoding standards needed to be merged into one through a process known as Han Unification. This was carried out by the Ideographic Research Group, a collaboration of universities, businesses, and other delegates from all over East Asia. Though an interesting but very bureaucratic process, the main conclusion of Han Unification was that the small regional stylistic changes between how characters were written did not constitute different graphemes, except in the case of Chinese simplification, where the overhaul was more extensive. And as another one of the goals of Unicode was to provide round-trip compatibility, meaning that Unicode could be translated into a regional encoding and back again without any data loss, then every character in these regional encodings had to be accounted for, which resulted in a few carryover symbols that probably wouldn't have been included otherwise. After several years of deliberation, the IRG submitted a list of 20,992 characters included in Unicode 1.0 as the CJK Unified Ideographs block, along with 302 CJK compatibility ideographs, as well as separate blocks for CJK symbols and punctuation, hiragana, katakana, bopomofo, jamo, CJK miscellaneous, enclosed CJK letters and months, CJK compatibility, and CJK compatibility forms. It's the latter blocks where code points like Japanese era names, the Japanese block for corporation, and the logo for the Japanese industrial standard are included for the aforementioned round-trip compatibility, though sadly, the Workers' Party of Korea logo has yet to be supported. But that's not to say it will never happen. The Unicode Consortium, the organization that maintains the encoding standard, knew that a 16-bit encoding was never going to be enough to encode the entire world's writing systems, nor was their work completed in 1991 after the publication of Unicode 1.0. In 1996, Unicode 2.0 expanded the system to have 1,114,112 code points, of which only a fraction have, as of yet, been assigned. But how are new characters added to Unicode? The process involves submitting an application for a new character or a set of characters, and providing documentation of these characters being used in the real world. Then the Unicode Consortium evaluates and reviews the proposal, and either accepts it or rejects it. The Ideographic Research Group, the same organization that completed Han Unification, took it upon themselves to, also very bureaucratically, compile a list of Chinese characters not yet added to the standard, and submit them to the consortium for approval. Their organization, along with others, have over the past few decades submitted the proposals that have become known as CJK Unified Ideographs Extension Block A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, and I. So if the consortium can approve all these characters, as well as cuneiform, Egyptian hieroglyphs, chess symbols, symbols for legacy computing, early dynastic cuneiform, ancient Greek musical notation, mahjong tiles, supplemental arrow C, shorthand format controls, playing cards, ornamental dingbats, counting rod numerals, enclosed alphanumeric supplement, alchemical symbols, and symbols and pictographs extended A, then surely a simple, well-documented character like Biang will be an easy addition. The first proposal to add Biang to the Unicode standard was submitted in 2006, but the character description was too long and it was missing the heart radical on the bottom of the character, so it was rejected. Another proposal was submitted in 2015, but this time the evidence was conflicting. It showed one version of the character with a knife radical and the other with a dagger radical, so it was rejected again. What's going on here? Aren't all Biang Biang noodles the same? Wait a minute. Look at that sign. And that one. And that one. It can't be. They're all different, what's going on? It seems there are no less than a dozen variants of this character ranging from 40 to 70 strokes, each not only with their own unique components, but they even have their own special rhymes to help you remember how to write it? And these are all claiming to be the one definitive way to write Biang? Well, it seems that as Biang Biang noodles spread, it began to change as well. Even what I'm eating here are the spicy Sichuan-style Biang Biang noodles, not the original Shaanxi style. And just like how the flavors now vary from place to place, so too does the character Biang. It isn't like there's some overbearing noodle authority enforcing consistency here. But the problem actually isn't that bad. Having a bunch of variant characters that all represent the same grapheme is actually the problem faced by Han Unification 30 years ago. In fact, Unicode is the perfect solution to this problem. Give Biang a code point, and then leave it to the font to decide how to display it. In March of 2020, the Biang character was added to the CJK Unified Ideograph Extension G block, and actually, two versions of it were added. The traditional Chinese version of the character at code point 30EDE, and the simplified version of the character at code point 30EDD. This is the standard version of the character, and this is the simplified version because, as mentioned earlier, Unicode has separate code points for simplified characters. So as of right now, you're able to represent this character in text data, a solid victory for noodle shops all throughout China. And this may not be the last we'll ever hear of the Biang character. The word sword has at least 21 different variants, many of which are already included in Unicode. So could there be a future where we'll be able to type a dozen different variants of Biang? I hope so, but until then.